Since all the COVID lockdown, people are feeling greater connection with the natural world around them than perhaps they did before. So it's a very good time to make a series on plants. We wanted to take the viewer across that barrier by going into time-lapse and by going into detail and seeing what that world is like on their timescale. And when you do that, you discover that plants are every bit as dynamic and inventive, and their lives are every bit as dramatic as animals. Well, my name is Rupert Barrington. I'm the series producer of The Green Planet. We thought it'd be better to see how plants deal with the particular challenges posed by environments. So, for example, a tropical rainforest, fresh water, deserts, the seasonal worlds.
I'm in Costa Rica, in the heart of a rainforest.
David Attenborough. And he said, I'd be really happy to be the guide for the viewer through this programme. And he was as energetic as anybody on the team. The story is you have the Taklamakan Desert, which is incredibly dry. It very, very rarely rains. So you find these beautiful poplar trees. And it turns out that they're all connected underground by the roots. And if one of these trees can get access to water, it can share the water through the roots to the other trees. If you go into a temperate forest, you find that many trees are connected underground by fungi. So when a tree in a temperate forest is dying, it will send all its nutrients down through this network to all the other trees around it to give them the nutrients before it dies. And the whole forest is in communication. And the final programme is called Human Worlds, and that deals with the plants which live around us. Obviously, we need to eat, but we've taken away all the normal great diversity of plants that live there and replaced them with one kind of plant. People are looking at us to finding ways to have crops alongside a greater level of plant biodiversity. There's a fantastic story from Kenya of people using sea balls to replant huge areas of forest. The Naturalist Unit hasn't done a series on plants for 26 years. Well, we had about a year of research, so probably one in every 50 stories of research we thought we could actually film. And there was a lot of new technology which would allow us to film plants in a fresh way. An American ex-military engineer, he spent 10 years building this robotics-controlled rig, and we used that to film the leafcutter ants. So the whole system had to move along that trail of ants. You're moving through the plant world at a normal walking speed, but everything you see around you is happening in time-lapse. So it does feel like you've allowed the viewer to walk into the plant's world and see it from their perspective on their timescale. That's never been done before. The giant water lily. And you can only film it by recreating perfectly this ecosystem. If you're going to reproduce a bit of the Brazilian wetlands in his studio in the UK, that's very, very difficult to do. And it's only when everything is perfect that you can reproduce exactly what would happen in the wild.
After it burned, they finally find the first signs of regeneration. Worryingly, however, more extreme wildfires may spell disaster.
My opinion on plants has definitely changed. I think when I go to these places, I'm increasingly aware of how wonderfully complicated they are, these natural systems, and there's a lot of damage around it. Every bit of wildness now is fragile and really, really precious. There's a great story from Brazil where somebody who owned an old cattle ranch, which used to be originally rainforest and it had been completely cleared and turned virtually into desert. They replanted the rainforest, just the trees, and all the other plants and their animals came back by themselves. But if we give plants space and time, they will rebuild ecosystems that we've lost. Those twin problems of the climate crisis and the biodiversity crisis, plants have a huge role to play in solving those problems if we will let them.